Hello, I'm Katya Adler from the BBC World Service. This is The Global Story. 2024 has been dubbed Election Year because nearly half of the world's population, that's 4 billion people, are eligible to vote, and almost 1 billion of those are in India alone. So that makes India's election this year the biggest democratic exercise and possibly the most expensive in the world. Polling stations need to be set up wherever people live in India. And in one of the largest and most populous countries in the world, that, as we're about to hear, isn't easy. So today we're asking, how does India run the world's biggest election? With me today are two BBC correspondents who've spent their lives in India, Soutik Biswas in Delhi. You've written a very detailed article on the BBC News website about the elections, which I recommend that our listeners pay close attention to. Hi, Soutik.
Hello.
And Devina Gupta, you're in London at the moment, in our London studio, but you've just come back from India where you were at a family wedding, I believe, and yes, talking to people in and outside the wedding about the elections. What's the mood, did you find?
The wedding was extremely colourful. There was a lot of chaos, and I can put those two words for people who are going into elections this time.
We're looking at votes for the lower house of parliament in India, the powerful lower house of parliament, at the Lok Sabha. Let's have a look at some of the mind-blowing numbers.
The numbers are always on the sides of not hundreds or thousands. We're talking about 968 million voters, nearly a billion voters.
But do we expect nearly 1 billion people to turn out to vote?
We have had the experience of turnouts of over 60%. So India is not like the US, where they have a problem getting voters to the polling booths. We have had recorded very high turnouts.
When India started elections in the 50s, it wasn't that they were excited to come out to vote. It was not even considered a civic duty in that sense. The turnout used to be extremely low.
There are so many eye-catching numbers when it comes to India's election, but also visually, in my mind, when I think about India and its vastness, and the difference of its geography, just where the voters are. So in India, every voter has to be a maximum of 2 kilometres away from a polling booth, so that making it easier for people to exercise their democratic right. What does that mean in practical terms?
You're looking at 5 million voting machines and 1 million polling booths. But I've travelled like 5 hours through a lion-infested forest in Gujarat. This was about 10 years ago, to reach a single voter at the end of the forest, which is in Gir, which has the largest population of the Asiatic land in the world. And there was one temple and there was one priest who was deep inside a forest, and he was waiting for the officials to come in. And so I think 10 of them went in, eventually set up a booth. He voted at 10 o'clock in the morning and they went back.
The other example I can give you is Pilopatia, which is completely at the southern tip in India, in Bay of Bengal and Indian Ocean, in a small island called Andaman and Nicobar Islands. The election officials have to take a boat, then a smaller boat, and then a dinghy, which we call it, because they have to change 3 times. Then they have to go through mangroves where there are crocodiles and all
that. That's right, crocodile-infested waters.
Yes.
I mean, this is dedication to democracy at a very high level, I have
For
to say.
9 voters. Can you believe that, Kat?
9.
9 voters. So if you're looking in a larger perspective, nearly a billion votes, how much difference would these votes make? But it's just also the symbolic gesture. It is also the way of saying India fought for this. Our founding fathers, when the British rule ended in 1947, ensured that there'll be a universal franchise, that men and women will get equal voting rights. And it's just carrying ahead that legacy.
India is one of the biggest countries in the world. How many election monitors will be needed?
Nearly 15 million. And I guess it would be 15 million plus, if at all, because a lot of people are recruited as the election goes on. These will be volunteers, these will be party cadres. There'll also be government teachers and government officials who are given a special day off so that they can be part of this machinery.
Soutik, where are most of the voters?
Most of India's voters are concentrated in the northern state of Uttar Pradesh, which is, I think, 240 million people live here, which is India's most populous state. I mean, more people live here than in Brazil or Pakistan. It's also a very important bellwether state. It sends the largest number of MPs to the parliament. Eight of India's prime ministers have come from the state. Even Mr. Modi, who is originally from Gujarat, chose Uttar Pradesh to make his debut as an MP in 2014. And analysts would tell you that the way to Delhi is through UP.
Okay, so now that we've looked at where the voters are, let's break down some of the numbers of who they are. Devina was saying lots of younger voters. How many first-time voters?
I think we're looking at nearly 18 million or more first-time voters between the age group of 18 to 19.
What about women voters, Devina?
Voting has been traditionally male-dominated in India, but there have been efforts to get more women out to vote. So this time round, 470 million voters, again, as Soutik mentioned, because of the increase in population, simple things like having separate queues at election booth for women. That has helped. There have been specific campaigns where women voters are encouraged to cast their vote away from what the family wants.
There's no one election day, right? Just because of the logistics of all of this.
They have to happen in a staggered manner, Katya, which means that they are organized in a way that different regions are covered on different dates. So this time there are seven phases of polls, and that'll happen over the course of 6 weeks or 44 days.
The cost of it all, I mean, India's elections are said to be the most expensive in the world. Is that fair? I mean, when you think about the US, it's election year there as well.
Yes, that's true. There are estimates of how much these elections cost, and by far, the estimate that I think I've zeroed down on is between $10 to $15 billion that was quoted by The Economist, that this is what Indian elections could cost this year. Now, compare that to the US, it lags far behind.
Who pays for all this?
Election financing is really the big elephant in the room. We still don't know who gives how much money. Most of it is through illicit money. A lot of it is through corporate donations. Some of it is contribution by party supporters. There have been many efforts to ensure a more transparent system, but I think it's failed. Till recently, anybody could buy an electoral bond of a party from a bank to donate money anonymously. The top court in India, the Supreme Court, scrapped it just before the elections this time.
How much taxpayers' money do we know flows into organising this election and campaigns, and how much private money or shadowy money?
Taxpayers' money would go into the nitty-gritties of the administrative work of putting these elections together. The illicit money would basically be campaign financing money, which the parties will be using. We really don't have a good ballpark on either of these, because how much the government spends on, you know, putting up election booths, paying salaries to workers, all that's coming out of taxpayers' money. So that's the administrative bit of India's elections. And then there is the party, the campaign financing, which the parties use to kind of push and campaign. So we really don't, I think we have a ballpark for any of these numbers. As I said, all these are guesstimates. Even The Economist amount is a guesstimate.
When we talk about this huge democratic process and we ask, is it free? Is it fair?
It's free. It's much more free than any time in history before, because in the 1970s and 80s, ballot boxes were looted and elections were usually extremely violent affairs. That's no longer the case. It's largely free. Is it fair? That's a big question. With such a dominant party, which is looking at the third term in power, which has a disproportionate share of resources, a very friendly media on its side, and so much of money and resources, I'm not very sure whether it's a level playing field anymore because of this gap between the incumbent and the rest of the party. So it's free, but the jury is out whether it's truly fair.
Devina and Soutik, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks for having me, Katya, and lovely to be on the show again. Thank you so much.
And thank you for watching us. You can also find us in podcast form. There's loads more episodes. Find us wherever you get your BBC podcasts. And don't forget to leave us a review, or you can leave your comment right here below.